Good evening, everyone. Welcome to TIFF Bell Lightbox. My name is Keith Benny. I'm the Senior Manager of Adult Learning here at TIFF. It's my pleasure to welcome you to this evening's special event, Paul Schrader on Revisiting Transcendental Style in Film, presented as part of Opening Frames, Cinema and Transcendence, a two-day conference on film and spirituality. To begin, we'd like to acknowledge the Mississaugas of New Credit, the Haudenosaunee, the Huron-Wendat, the original keepers of this land, for hosting us today and for hosting TIFF on their land every day. On behalf of TIFF, I'd like to thank our lead sponsor, Bell, our major sponsors, RBC, L'Oréal Paris, and Visa, as well as our major public supporters, the Government of Canada, the Government of Ontario, and the City of Toronto. As a charitable organization, we'd also like to thank our donors and members for supporting TIFF's year-round programming, our educational and community outreach initiatives. A few reminders, we ask that you please place your phones on silent. Taking photo or recording video is not allowed at any point during the event. During the Q&A, there will be an opportunity for you to ask questions of our guest. We just ask that you please wait for a microphone to reach you before asking your question. We'd like to send a huge thank you to our event partners, the Institute for Christian Studies Center for Philosophy, Religion, and Social Ethics, as well as Ryerson University and Imago. It's been really energizing to work together with John Caruana and Ron Kuipers on the Opening Frames Conference, so we'd like to extend a big thank you to them for all of their hard work on the conference planning. So round of applause, please, for them. So just a quick overview of how tonight's event will run. After these introductory remarks, we'll welcome Paul Schrader to present his talk, and then he'll be joined by Professor Joseph Kikasola for an onstage conversation about the themes of that talk, and then we'll turn it over to you for your questions. So when we opened our year-round building back here in 2010, we had really great hopes for the types of activities we'd be presenting for Toronto audiences. Events and series that consider film as an art form, that explore the key figures and aesthetic movements that have shaped our understanding of the moving image, and to cultivate cinephilic discussion and camaraderie. And tonight's event is incredibly special and one that fulfills the promise of that mandate. We're greatly honored to have prolific screenwriter and director Paul Schrader here with us tonight to present for the first time publicly his rethinking of transcendental style before an updated edition of his 1972 book is republished by the University of California next year. We're humbled and thrilled that he's here in Toronto to share this new work with us tonight. We have been so inspired by Mr. Schrader's visit that our senior programmer, James Quant, has programmed a film series this spring on the themes of transcendental style. From April 8th to 25th, TIFF will present Transcendental Style, Spirituality in the Films of Bresson, Dreyer, and Ozu, a combined mini-retrospective on the film on the subjects of Mr. Schrader's book. We encourage you to join us for an opportunity to see these important works on the big screen, which I'm happy to let you know will all be presented in 35mm. And to link them with the talk this evening, carrying these themes well into the year. For the full schedule of screenings, please visit tiff.net. We begin on April 8th with Diary of a Country Priest. That's all for me, but if you've ever been to a keynote before, you know that the introductions continue. So to introduce our host and our moderator for this evening and to provide welcome remarks on behalf of the Institute for Christian Studies, please join me in welcoming Ron Kuipers.
Thanks, Keith. Thank you, everybody, for coming out tonight to the special event that has been a while in the planning. My name's Ron Kuipers. I'm an associate professor of philosophy of religion at the Institute for Christian Studies in Toronto, and I'm also the director of the Center for Philosophy, Religion, and Social Ethics. So tonight's keynote address by Paul Schrader is actually part, in addition to being a ticketed TIFF event, it's part of a two-day conference we've planned on film and spirituality, as Keith said, called Opening Frames, Cinema and Transcendence. And part of the reason I'm not a cinephile, I'm not a film scholar, I'm a philosopher of religion, but part of what we wanted to do with this conference is with the example of film, try to create a space, a cultural space that is, I think, far too rare in our time, where people from different backgrounds, religious backgrounds, no religion, can talk about a common human experience of, coming up against transcendence, spirituality, mystery, these kinds of things, in a way, in a safe space that's decharged from all the polemical cultural wars and the certainties of different entrenched positions. And so the two-day conference that we're having is kind of about creating that kind of space. And we're really happy at how it's come together. Happy to have Paul Schrader come and speak tonight. I'd just like to take this time to thank all of the partners. This conference we're doing is really the result of a partnership between TIFF, TIFF's Higher Learning Program, the center that I direct at the Institute for Christian Studies, Imago, Christian Artists Group, and the Faculty of Arts at Ryerson University. So I'd like to thank all those sponsors. So then it also falls to me tonight to introduce Joel Kikasola, who will be moderating. The Schrader will come up here and give a keynote address, but there will also be an interview, and Joel Kikasola will be the interviewer. Joe is he's a professor at the Baylor in New York program. He's the director of the Baylor Communications in New York program. So he's a faculty member in their Department of Film and Digital Media. And he specializes in, among other areas, philosophy and religion and film, film theory, and phenomenology in film. So I'd like you to now help me welcome Joel Kikasola to the stage.
Good evening and welcome to a very, very special event. I think it's going to be a delightful evening and talking about a very, very important topic. A little over 20 years ago when I was in graduate school and I was working on a research project that would eventually become a book on the Polish filmmaker Krzysztof Kieślowski, I sensed in Kieślowski a filmmaker who was not committed to religious dogma, but was very concerned with what we'd call spiritual questions, the deepest and most important questions. And so as a result of who he was using cinematic language to express these questions, rather than typical religious language. And I thought to myself, who on earth has written about this? And the answer was, no one, except for Paul Schrader. This book here, Transcendental Style and Film, Ozu, Bresson, Dreyer, was a guiding light for me in that particular period. And I was just speaking with Paul recently, and he said 5 months ago, he was on the New York City subway and sat right across from a young man reading Transcendental Style and Film. This book, copyright 1972, 45 years later, is still being read, is still the touchstone for the conversation about how film form can be spiritually expressive. So you are here for a very unique and important conversation. Paul Schrader is the director of about 20 feature films, many of them award-winning. Mishima in particular was honored at the Cannes Film Festival and is released on the Criterion Collection, which for me is the great award of all time, really. He's also made other very significant films like Affliction. He's known for American Gigolo. He spans all different sorts of genres. He's a very, very, he's a cinephile, really. And that's why he makes so many different kinds of films, and that's one of the reasons why filmmakers love him and love his work. He's also famous for his work with Martin Scorsese as one of Scorsese's go-to screenwriters, penning Taxi Driver, Raging Bull, The Last Temptation of Christ, and Bringing Out the Dead. Please give a warm round of applause for director Paul Schrader.
Well, I'm really glad to be in Toronto. In fact, I swear the airplane gasped a sigh of relief when we entered Canadian airspace. Unfortunately, the airplane will have to go back. So I've written out some comments. Thank you all for coming. I'm a church kid. I was a product of the Christian Reformed Church, which was a Calvinist denomination in the Midwest. A product of Westside Christian School, Grand Rapids Christian High, Calvin College and Seminary. When I was young, theater attendance was not approved of by our church, so I had very little exposure to films. And then the 60s came along and like a howling wind and hauled me away. and I moved my interest to a pulpit of a different sort, transferred my interest in matters theological to a love of cinema, specifically the European cinema of the 60s. I moved to Los Angeles and became a film student and a film critic. But I remained curious. What was the connection to the world in which I was then living and the world which I had come from? In certain films, I sensed a kind of link between my past and my present, between the sacred and the profane, between the spiritual life of the Christian and the commercial life of a film. But that link was not content, it was style. And this is the insight I had, it's the insight others have had before me. Spirituality and art are not connected by the how. I mean, by the what. They are connected by the how. Spirituality is a way of believing, but more importantly, it's a way of believing that is accessed by a way of doing. So at the age of 24, I wrote Transcendental Style and Film. I realized I was too young to write the book at the time, but I also realized that if I didn't write it then, I never would, because I saw another career on the horizon. And I realized I didn't think anybody else would write it either. In that book, I proposed, the transcendental style that I proposed was based on the films of Bresson, Ozu, Dreyer, and some others. I saw that they were using film techniques in a similar ways to bring the viewer into contact with the invisible, the ineffable, the holy other, or in Zen terms, the Mu. These techniques were, to varying degrees, withholding techniques. That is, they kept expected and desired elements away from the viewer. The essence of motion pictures is action and empathy. It's built into the title. Motion, action, empathy, pictures. You see a photograph, you have an empathetic reaction. You see motion, that's motion. So these are the two great engines that pull the commercial train of cinema forward. Action and empathy define the commercial appeal of movies. Transcendental style and other withholding styles work against action and empathy. If you are, they work against the things that make movies commercial, which they work against the things that we like about the movies. If you like action, transcendental style will offer inaction. People will walk very slowly, and they'll talk slowly, and sometimes they won't hardly talk at all. And you'll have long static shots of tableaus, and excessively long shots. Take one example of a withholding technique, which is the delayed cut. Now, in a normal film, if a man enters or exits a room, the splice is made as the door opens or as the door closes. What you started to see in these withholding techniques, particularly with Bresson, was he would cut to the door. One, two, three, the door opens. Someone leaves the room, door closes. One, two, three, cut. Now, that is withholding something from the viewer that they expect. It is displacing the viewer. Because in real life, when somebody walks out of the room, we don't stare at the door for 3 seconds or 4 seconds. Our mind moves on to something else. But when you're watching this film, all of a sudden you're just looking at a closed door for 4 seconds. Well, that is disrupting you. That's withholding something from you that you have expected from the movies, which is a certain pace. And it is a tool which the filmmaker is using. The other engine, empathy, a transcendental style will short you on empathy too. You will have low-key performances, sometimes by non-actors. Scenes will be shot and edited against your empathetic needs. You know, normally, master over the shoulder, close up during a certain moment, high angle, low angle, these tell you how to feel. In these techniques, the filmmaker are guiding your emotions through the scene. You should feel this now, feel that now, because of the cutting pattern. Well, when you don't cut, like in the films of the New Romanian cinema, where you just sit there and two people are on screen for 3, 4, 5 minutes, well, you have to start doing the editing yourself. And that is a whole very different process than the editorial winks and nudges that we are used to. The same holds true with music. The simplest and most effective way to dictate a viewer's response to an image is underscoring. Happy, scared, sad. You know, we'll tell you exactly what to feel. Don't worry about how you feel, because you're supposed to feel sad. So we'll play sad music. In these films of Transcendental Style and similar styles, there's very little underscoring. There's none at all. Films like Blue and Demand, no underscoring whatsoever. Or often if there is, it's inappropriate. So that Ozu will have a sad scene, but he won't play sad music. Then he'll have an empty scene with a vase or a train station, and then he'll play the sad music. So it's not when you expect it. Bresson, you know, will have all these scenes without music, and then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, for no reason, he sort of plays Mozart for a while. Well, why are these directors working against the very qualities that make motion pictures unique, the very things we like about motion pictures? It is because they have a different agenda. Their agenda is not solely to divert, entertain, and amuse. They would like to, in some way, bring the viewer closer to the mystery, the unknown, the capital M mystery. Transcendental Style takes a lean back approach. Most films lean in. They lean in very aggressively. They lean right toward you, the viewer, and grab you by the throat and try. They stare you right in the eye and try to dictate everything you're supposed to feel right now. Contemplative films lean away from you. They don't try to control you. They encourage you to lean forward. And that is the moment when the magic starts, when a film can make you lean into it. Because there's no great thrill of being having emotions dictated and lean into you. But when you start leaning into a film, all of a sudden things start happening because you're doing it and the filmmaker's not doing it. An artist cannot bring the viewer into the presence of the mystery by leaning into him. It just doesn't work that way. Just like you cannot have fast meditation. You know, it doesn't work. You can try it, it ain't gonna work. So Transcendental Style then is a process, it is a way, it is a towel. But at what point does the artist lean too much away? At what point does he withdraw too much? At what point is boredom not simply an aesthetic tool you can use like a scalpel, but simply boredom, you know? Well, that's the elusiveness of these contemplative spiritual styles, because you have to be able to use boredom and not be boring at the same time. Now, there's been a lot, side point, there's been a lot of noise recently about faith-based films. These are not transcendental films. These are not spiritual films. These are routine Hollywood melodramas, full of action, full of empathy. They're all the conventional narrative tricks and devices and ploys that we use to manipulate your emotion. They're just now being done in God's name. You know, it's like a Madonna done by Rubens or a Christ done by Montaigne. These are not spiritual works of art. These are religious works of art, but they're not spiritual works of art. So the book was published, and I began a career in the film industry. I had loved this type of spiritual film, but I had no interest in making one myself. I was too intoxicated by action and empathy. And occasionally over the years, someone would ask if I thought Transcendental Style still existed, and I would say yes, but in truth, I wasn't really paying that much attention. Then over a year ago, I was invited to observe a panel at SCMS organized by Chris Ruiz Proveda. It was called Rethinking Transcendental Style, and Ms. Proveda and Joe Kixola and Dan Choikin gave reappraisals of my 45-year-old book. This was in Atlanta. And listening to them, I thought, wait, if somebody is rethinking Transcendental Style, shouldn't it be me? And so I started rethinking. And then I've now written a longish essay under that title, which will be the front piece or the introduction to a new edition of the book that University of California Press is publishing next year. So what was my rethinking? What did I do? And on, I had to start watching a lot of movies, a lot of slow movies. And believe me, they're making slow movies faster than we can watch them. Well, what happened to Transcendental Style? Well, Gilles Deleuze happened, and then Andrei Tarkovsky happened, and then slow cinema happened. What I didn't realize in 1972 was that what I was calling Transcendental Style was actually an outgrowth of post-war neorealism. We can now see that in perspective. I was part of the insight that Deleuze brought to the discussion with his books on movement image and time image in 1984 and 86. Deleuze classified film shots as one of two types: shots which express the motion of an object, and shots which express the time an object was viewed. Now, I am not a Deleuze scholar, and I'm pretty clearly over my head here, but I think it's pretty hard to deny that beginning in the late 40s, certain narrative films began to slow their pace and linger over images and began to mix movement images with the whatever, to time images. This is jargon. I'm gonna start talking about diegetic style in a minute. Both Andre Bazin and Deleuze pointed to the same scene as the birth of the time image movement. And it was a scene from De Sica's Umberto D. And in that scene, the maid of the house, a very minor character in the film, gets up and goes to make some coffee. And she strikes a match against the wall to light the stove. The match doesn't light. Strikes it again. This time it lights. She goes to light the stove, turns on the gas, and the match goes out, turns off the gas. She reaches up, grabs another match, strikes it. This time it does light. This time she turns it to the stove, and this time the stove turns on. Well, what are we watching here? We're not watching a stove being lit. We're watching the process, the time it takes for that stove to be lit. It's not about the movement of the match. It's about the time the match is on screen. And this shift from movement image to time image, it's not really a shift, it's just a mixing of the two. Like Bresson realized that this protraction of time, pulling out time unnecessarily, has a phenomenological effect. When the image takes longer to view than the viewer expects, the viewer becomes aware of watching something over time. This is what Bergson called la durée, the duration. The duration of the experience. Duration changes the relationship between the seer and the object seen. If I look at that doorway for 3 seconds, that's one thing. Well, what if I hold it on screen for 30 seconds? That's another duration. What if I hold it on screen for 3 minutes? Well, that's another duration. Those are not the same thing. It isn't just longer, it's a different experience because your mind starts to create the movie. You know, it's just like you have in those Bella Tower films where a character walks across screen. Now you know from watching this film that that guy who enters on the upper right corner, if he's headed toward the lower left corner, they're not going to cut till he gets there. And he's going to walk slow. And then even after he exits frame, they'll probably still hold a little longer. So now you're watching them go, and you're saying, okay, what else is going on? Well, you see some cows. Oh, yeah, there's interesting cows, and the clouds, and you hear the wind. And then you hear a car coming. So, oh, there's a car coming. Nope, car's not coming. But the cows have moved. What's happening here? You're making a movie. He's forcing you to make your own movie. And he's using his techniques to bring you into the process. And that's what Bresson sort of realizes, that you can force people to come into you if you withhold things from them. Bresson and Ozu and Rossellini used duration to create a meditative cinema. Mizoguchi and Antonioni used it to create a contemplative cinema. And people have been using it ever since for different reasons. At the same time that Deleuze was formulating his theories, Tarkovsky was putting them into practice. Influenced by Bresson, Tarkovsky brought distancing and withholding devices, such as the long take, the delayed cut, to a larger canvas encompassing science fiction, dreams, memory, history, metaphysics, poetic realism. Ozu's theme was the family, Bresson's theme was the individual, Tarkovsky's theme was memory, time itself, history. And although Tarkovsky used elements of transcendental style, I would not describe him as a transcendental artist, or certainly not as a purist. He had religious themes, obsessions, characters. He was austere. He employed distancing devices, but his intent was different. A real transcendental guide, or a guru, or director, self-effacingly seeks to escort his respondent to another level of consciousness, to the holy other world. He or she is a spirit guide. Tarkovsky was more interested in passing the portal himself than taking you there. This became clear to me in watching Nostalgia, his film in Italy. At the end of the film, Dominic, a deranged mystic, immolates himself. In response, Andre, the film's protagonist and Tarkovsky's surrogate, fulfills a promise to Dominic to carry a candle across the waters of a mineral pool. The pool is empty, but Andre struggles against the wind and his failing health to complete the task, back and forth, back and forth. He finally places the flickering candle on the ledge, steps off camera, and dies. And we are left looking at the flickering camera. This is the Bressonian ending. This is how Diary of a Country Priest ends. The priest is dead, we look at the cross. This is how Joan of Arc ends. You look at the, Joan of Arc is dead, you look at the burning stake. Stasis, the meditative image. But not how Tarkovsky ends it. He goes back and attaches another ending. A black and white tableau of poetic realism, where Andre, in a frozen frame, sits by his dog in front of a reflecting pool in front of his family house as the camera pulls back to reveal that Andre is, in fact, with his dog and his house and his pool in the inside a large ruined church. And then the rain starts falling. Now it's not real. It's all about Tarkovsky's memory. It's not about the about taking you to the place where you look at the candle. But so cinema, in my opinion, is inherently narrative. This is also, you know, an opinion. When a photographed image occurs through time, that is narrative. When two moving images are joined, the seer and the seen thing seen, they recreate a narrative relationship. There's been a lot written about the growth and complexity of film narrative, but what happens when film narrative dissembles? What happens when it becomes anti-narrative? What happens when the movement image becomes the time image and action becomes duration? These are the questions raised by slow cinema, the movement that followed Tarkovsky and the movement all around us now. As cinema moved away from its narrative beginnings, it had to vector in one of three paths. And each one of these paths becomes more pure, more theoretical, and less populist. The three endpoints which anti-narrative must go to, and necessarily as it flees narrative. One is the surveillance camera, which is just unending reality. So in Umberto D, we watched the maid strike her match for 7 or 8 seconds. In 1975, she had grown up to become Jean Dielman in Chantal Ackerman's film, and we watched her do household tasks for around 20 minutes. And then a few years ago, in a Chinese film by Jian Liu, Oxide 2, she became the people who prepare dumplings for 132 minutes in 9 shots. Surveillance camera becomes, the duration becomes a surveillance camera. So I can set up a surveillance camera right here and show you, and that camera will be showing you forever. And that movie will go on forever. That is an anti-narrative. The other two endpoints, one is the art gallery, which is pure shape and color. So that what sort of began with Maya Deren after World War II, you know, evolves to Stan Brakhage, and now Bill Viola, where it is essentially an art installation. And it's almost impossible to go to an art gallery today and not see a movie. And all the galleries and museums have screens. And in these screens, you see the anti-narrative of pure imagery. The third pole it strikes toward to be in its search for purity and anti-narrative is the mandala, the pure meditative, the candle, the cross, the mandala, which can simply be watched in a meditative way forever. Now, what defines these three tendencies of narrative to come apart and collapse and become anti-narrative is the Tarkovsky ring, which is the Tarkovsky ring defines the point at which anti-narrative moves from being populist to being pure, when it moves from communication to essence. Now, one could draw up a chart plotting where various films and filmmakers rest in this zodiac of anti-narrative. In fact, I have. It's going to be in that article. And, you know, if you look at the Tarkovsky ring, you know, Bill Sloan, he'll be right inside the ring. And Bellatar, he's just outside the ring. But that ring sort of defines the movement away from cinema as communication and the movement toward essence. All the artists we're talking about in terms of transcendental style are clearly within the ring. They want to communicate. They want to have an effect. They're not so committed to purity that they will give up an audience to be pure. So in closing, I just return to the question of transcendental style. Are there films still of transcendental style today? And I would say yes. You know, inside the Tarkovsky ring, they employ duration. They use boredom as an aesthetic tool, but their goal is to bring the viewer closer to the other, to the mystery and to transcendence. They employ transcendental techniques of quotidien, the everyday, disparity, decisive action, stasis, but they employ them in different degrees. It's like there's a buffet of techniques, and every filmmaker who's interested in contemplative cinema goes to the buffet and picks up different items and assembles them in his own way. But they are essentially the same buffet. You know, you're going to find that there's basically about 10 or so techniques that they're going to turn to, such as the static shot or the lack of music and so forth. The films that have occurred in the last years that I would categorize as using transcendental style, because there can be no such thing as a pure transcendental style, because everyone who is interested in this creates their own. But Alexander Sokurov's Mother and Son, Carlos Regado's Silent Light, Bruno Dumont's Haydwitz, Jessica Hauser's Lords, Pavel Pavlovsky's Ida, and Eugene Green's Sapienza. These films use elements of transcendental style, so it is something that is ongoing. But one thing I did learn in studying and researching this is that it's not programmatic. It's not like there's a recipe, and you fill the recipe, the cake will always rise. Sometimes it doesn't rise. It's as instinctive and by the seat of your pants as any other kind of filmmaking. And, you know, you can't make a film like Bresson, because Bresson can't make a film like Bresson, because he doesn't quite know how he made it, you know? And that's, you know, that's the magic of art, and certainly the magic of art which tries to, you know, truck with mystery. So, how long was that?
Can you hear us?
Good. You know, test your mic there, Paul. Good.
Thank you, Paul. It's a really great thing, particularly as a film scholar, to hear an authority on the subject rethink the subject 45 years later. And there is this sense if I'm reading you right, you feel like you really were onto something when you were 24 years old, and you're sticking by it. At the same time, there's other things that you think maybe you missed a little bit and you'd like to revisit. So we want to encapsulate what you think you got right and maybe what you missed.
Well, as I was just saying, I didn't realize, when you're in the middle of a thing, you can't see it in much perspective. And I didn't realize that what I was seeing in Bresson, Ozu, Bizoguchi, Antonioni, to a lesser degree, René, Rossellini, was the same stuff. You know, that Antonioni and Bresson were really up to the same thing. They just, you know, were, you know, Antonioni was going for a kind of you know, weariness. And Bresson was going for a kind of escape of the soul. But they were using the same techniques. And it was obviously Deleuze, whose works had not been published at that time, that made it clear why that was happening. You know, this idea of what happens to the mind when it is made to wait, yet enjoys waiting. Because obviously, if you're made to wait when you don't enjoy it, you will turn off or you will leave. But if you enjoy waiting, then interesting things start to happen. And movies hadn't been doing that much, like that very much. They still don't, but more and more of them do.
We're not known for being a patient culture. So if more and more of them are doing it, and you're seeing some of these techniques, such as the filmmakers you mentioned there at the end, are you seeing that as a reaction to a culture, or are you seeing some other factors at play?
Yeah, it's more powerful to be slow now than it was 10 or 15 years ago, because everything is moving so fast. You know, I'm sure you've all seen the studies of how the number of splices in a film, you know, doubles about every 20 years, and then they're just shooting. And our brains, of course, are retrained by our media to accept multimedia in a very fast fashion. We can watch several screens at the same time, and it can be images, and we will follow it. Our parents would have just said, "What is that? You know, I don't get it." But we get it because we've retrained our brains. So if you have brains that have been retrained to experience imagery at a faster clip, then it's more powerful to not move fast, because it really will throw the brain when you don't move hardly at all. So part of the slow cinema movement is a reaction against the speed of the culture and the speed of the media. And so it can be used, you know, for an effective purpose in that way. I was just saying to Joe, I saw a film last night by Osgood Perkins, Anthony Perkins' son. And it's a horror film, and it was called Black Coat's Daughter. It just came out. And it is full of all these techniques. They're not really working. He's stuck in a horror context, and you can tell he doesn't really care that much about horror. But what he does care is about slowness and about time. And so the film doesn't really work because it's not scary enough. But once he gets onto the right subject matter, it will work.
I wanted to ask you along those lines. Like, so you mentioned Antonioni, for instance, and you say what he was after was a type of alienation, right? And he's using slowness and many of these same techniques that Bresson was using and all that. And granted, they're different. I'm sure you would say that. Yeah. What I'm asking myself, though, is when we're talking about transcendental style, does the aim matter? I mean, you said in the book that in religious traditions, for instance, you're establishing stasis or frozen motion, and it's the trademark of religious art in every culture. It establishes an image of a second reality which can stand beside the ordinary reality, and it represents the holy other. That doesn't sound like something Antonioni would say,
no.
But yet it's still the same technique. So is he in the ring? Is he out of the ring? Technique, or is it just...
Yeah, obviously he's in the ring because he's interested in commercial cinema and audiences. You only get out of the ring when you don't care about what I'm going to think anymore. When you start going Bellatar on the audience and saying, "Why are you still here?" he said that to an audience once. You know, here's a very interesting thing. Theoretically, these techniques are not, not denominational, are not connected to religion per se. They are a kind of meditative technique that is used the world over, and now art uses them. So theoretically, you should be able to use these techniques on any subject. But it seems to work better when the subjects are spiritual. I mean, Andy Warhol can show the Empire State Building for 8 hours. But when you start looking at the ones that work, and I just mentioned the list I mentioned, Hate, which is a religious subject, Lords is, Silent Light is, and what I didn't mention, Therese is. So somehow, Ida is. So somehow they do kind of work better when the subject and the style line up. But theoretically, they shouldn't. You should be able to do it without the subject being religious.
So is it fair to say then, okay, so to stick with the Antonioni example, or maybe to use a different Bellatar movie, not one that holds the audience in quite so much contempt, if you wanted to take The Turin Horse, which is very reasonable film, only about 2 hours. Feels like 4 or 6, but it's about 2 hours. So that has a lot of repetition in it. Basically, it's a week in the life of a starving peasant family. Many, many things repeated over and over and over again, including a potato meal that they have to share together. I have the sense that that's not just an experiment in time or an experiment with boredom. That seems to be expressing a vacuous spiritual hole. And in fact, there is a vacuous spiritual hole in that movie in the form of a well that has been mysteriously drained of water. So is it fair to say that when we see the transcendental style, without being dogmatic about the direction of the styles, the spiritual question is always implied?
Yeah. I mean, are we alone? You know, is there anything out there? You know, when I say God's name, can he hear it? Or am I just sitting in a room, saying Yahweh? If you know the answer to that one, you're in a good place. But it is, the biggest question. And it's one that, it's just where art and religion meet, that intersection.
Because it seems like, and I disagree with you on Tarkovsky, but it seems to me from your Tarkovsky example, the reason you want to keep Tarkovsky out of the ring or have him define the ring, he is the ring, okay, but you don't want to quite grant him transcendental style status, because he doesn't stick with the blown-out candle. He expresses a poetic image that combines home and church, that combines immanence, materiality, and the cosmos and transcendence. Yeah, and that has a lot of theological basis.
But essentially,
basis.
It's about him. The candle is about the other. The guy with his dog is about Andrei Tarkovsky.
Yeah, but isn't the cathedral about the other? I'm wondering if you have a problem with Tarkovsky because he seems to be saying he has had a genuine religious experience, and you're more comfortable with those who are saying the questions.
I just have a problem is that he thinks the movie is about him. And I think that if you're going to work in these transcendental fields, you have to realize it's not about you anymore.
Fair statement. Certainly that last part anyway. I'm still sticking by Tarkovsky, though. Americans don't typically do transcendental style, or slow cinema, for that matter, but there's a few that come to mind. Kelly Reichardt is one that comes to mind.
And then there's the Walking Trilogy, the Death Trilogy by Gus Van Sant.
Okay, Gus Van Sant.
Elephant, Jerry, what's the third one?
Shout it out louder. Las Vegas.
Yeah. So, Gus went in and did 3 films in that style. This is kind of amazing for someone who has worked in other styles.
Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, in the more popular cinema, which is clearly not outside the ring, right? That's the whole point. if there are elements that might come in. So films that the more popular audiences might be a little more familiar with. Moments. Now, you mentioned Ida and some of these other foreign cinema, but I'm wondering about the American cinema. Do we see? So what comes to my mind, for instance, is the end of a film called Big Night, Stanley Tucci's in. And unlike the rest of that film, which is very much psychological realism, standard kind of genre fare in a way, the last 10 minutes of that movie is of two brothers who, after a kind of traumatic incident, not getting their restaurant off the ground, everything going well, it's a planimetric shot is what Bordwell calls it. Basically a giant tableau, a stage. Everybody moves within the frame. The camera doesn't move. And one brother makes breakfast for the other brother with no words spoken. It's about 10 minutes long. That, to me, is very much in the style. It's not characteristic of the whole movie, but it ends the movie, and it ends it beautifully. Can you think of other examples where this might be making its impact?
Before, we were talking about the opening of Let There Be Blood. I mean, in this essay, I go through probably six or seven elements. There could be more. One of them is the planimetric composition, which Wes Anderson also uses, for a different reason. Another is center punching. Now, when you center punch a movie, you put the person right square in the center. Normally, every conversation that you see in a film, the intercutting, one character will be slightly to the right, the other character will be slightly to the left on the screen, and that makes for smooth editing. Or there will be overs. What you start seeing is center punching, fewer overs, planimetric, lack of music, heightened sound effects. Things are too loud. The wind is too loud. And all these various devices. So, as I said before, it is like this big buffet, and a director who wants to work on the quiet side, who wants to work on the contemplative side, looks over the buffet and says, "Well, I'll take a little bit of that, and I'll take a little bit of that." But if they take the whole buffet, it'll be unwatchable.
Yeah, for sure. I think that we've had a really interesting discussion going on here, and we're talking about a very particular type of filmmaking, but you can see that actually within this particular type, there's a lot of variety, and there's a lot of films, and one of the things Paul set out to do when he wrote that book, he says, I want to go across cultures. This isn't, so you're talking about a Danish Protestant, you're talking about a French Catholic, and you're talking about a Japanese Buddhist, I suppose. Do you ever say particularly where he's coming from? But anyways, cross-cultural, pan-religious, it was, and you can see that still continuing because it's rooted in some of the most important questions that we ask ourselves. I'd like to open this up to the audience. I'm not quite sure how we do this with the microphones and such. Maybe somebody can instruct me. Okay, so how should we move forward? Okay, there, if you raise your hand, I will point to you and we'll get a microphone to you. And I'd be happy to, right here down front, in the second row here. Oh, is there a microphone coming or just? Okay.
Yeah. We can repeat it too. Yeah. As long as it's within 3 minutes of length. Absolutely. I discussed Terry in that. He's definitely working on the quiet side. He's definitely using these techniques. But what is he after quite exactly? Some kind of pantheistic mumbo jumbo. I'm not quite sure what it is. And I know some people feel deeply moved by it, and there are a few moments in some of the films where he absolutely captures a time and a place. But for most of it, I think it's just... I'm mystified. I don't understand why people... become Malickians. I can understand why you would become a Tarantino-lite, but I don't quite understand why you become a Malikian. I just don't get the appeal. I was the first year of AFI started. Terry and I were students together, so I've heard this in 1972. I was hearing this from him, so I never understood it. I didn't understand it back then, and I still don't.
Yes, there in the middle.
Thank you, and it's great to hear you speak. Thanks for being here. All right, thank you for being here. It's great to hear you speak. Can you say a little bit about the use of sound in this style? And there's been an interesting thing. You've been talking about this quiet style, and then you say loud sounds. So what's the language here? What's the sound doing?
Well, I mean, it starts when you remove underscoring. So what they call non-diegetic movement music, because underscoring is such a crutch. So the moment you remove underscoring, people are sitting there and they're having to figure out what their emotion should be. You know, these two people are talking, and there's no guide for me. It's not being cut in such a way that I know what's important. There's no music to tell me that this is kind of spooky. So I'm kind of thinking it up. Well, what you do then in the place of music is you put in sounds. Now, you know, the wind is too loud, or there's a dog barking, or there's somebody walking upstairs. And this adds to your power over the viewer because you are giving them information in an unsettling way, and they're having to process it. You know, it's just like, you know, that shot I mentioned earlier, you hear a car in the distance, you say, oh, a car is coming, and then the car doesn't come. What I found in these films, as you can see, and I first noticed it in Bresson, is certain things were always too loud, you know? Footsteps were too loud. And iron on iron sounds were just a little too loud. And since this began also in neorealism because they weren't doing sync sound at that time, so everything was being done in post. So all the dialogue was added in post, which meant they added all the sound effects in post, which means they didn't add that many because they didn't have that much money. So you would just like hear only the footsteps and the door. You wouldn't hear the ambience of the room. You wouldn't hear the clock. But now, when then the Dreyer comes along, and all of a sudden, there's a clock. You hear the clock. You know, it's too loud. The clock's too loud. Norman Mailer said that about Andy Warhol's films. And what he loved about Andy Warhol's films was the refrigerator was always too loud. You know, the way that reality can manipulate you, and you think you're not being manipulated because it's not doing so musically.
Right here.
Third row, please.
Hi. So this is a question I've wanted to ask you for 30 years since reading it. All the effects, you know, you mention are all by dialing it down. But it seems to me that in your work as well. You can point beyond the screen. It might not be spiritual, but it's cultural. You can point beyond it. You can play if you dial it right the way up. You know, so, and dog eat dog.
Yeah.
Dog eat dog.
Yeah. I mean, dog eat dog is an excess. It's just everything is excessive. The behavior is as profane and sacrilegious as I could get. I really do think it is withholding. If you are going to get people to quiet down and to look inside and see things in their essence, you have to lower the temperature and you have to slow them down. And the whole thing is you can't have fast meditation. Now, if meditation is the goal, you know, what you do is you listen to your own breath, and even more than you listen to music. And how can you listen to your own breath when there's all this other noise around? So art is great at being over the top and excessive and surreal and completely wacky, but that's not the techniques we're talking about in this context. So I don't quite understand your question. Of course art can be excessive, but, no, but spiritual art can't be excessive. I don't think that Hieronymus Bosch is a spiritual artist. I mean, I think all
Shakespeare
that
is.
What?
Shakespeare is.
I'm
He's
not sure
going
about
crazy.
But I'm not sure about that either. Right. I mean, I have a very narrow definition of what it means to be a spiritual contemplative artist. And it's very close to the definition of what it means to be a spiritual counselor. And just because you have religious subjects and just because you have a religious emotion and just because the Archbishop of Canterbury gets killed doesn't mean that's a spiritual film. So I really bracketed it down because otherwise everything, and then I'm sure in this audience you have all encountered people who have given religious interpretations to the most unlikely, inappropriate films. And simply because you can do it. I can always interpret Quentin Tarantino's Django Unchained as a statement against whatever, name what, some religious thing. You can interpret anything. But I think in order to have a valid conversation, you have to be very restrictive in what you call spiritual or religious. Or not religious, spiritual or contemplative.
Along those lines, though, it seems, I get that you're saying it, this whole wholly other category, this kind of other reality, that's why you keep it narrow, because you don't want to lose that distinction. But in many religious testimonies across many traditions, a glorious and inexpressible joy is Paul's phrase, right? Saint Paul in Christianity, but other religions have other traditions. I don't see you describing joy or emotion, because your the style for spiritual expression is necessarily de-dramatized, no emotion, ascetic. Is there a way to do extraordinary miracle in the style that entails emotion, a positive emotion even?
Well, ayahuasca. I would feel that an ayahuasca experience is a spiritual experience, and it is a completely colorful and over the top. So yes, there are must be ways. It's just that there is another side, you know, and sometimes, you know, the sun does shine on the unhappy. And sometimes you have a burst of joy. I don't quite know how to do that in an entertainment complex context without making it feel like I'm giving you my emotion. You know, how do I make you come at me with joy? You know, if I show you a mother and a child and a sunset with wonderful music, and you have an emotion, that's a synthetic emotion. I want to show you a Rothko, and I want you to say, I feel such joy.
Yes, down front here.
I mean, I think one of the most religious environments ever created is the Rothko Chapel. I think it is far more spiritual than many cathedrals.
Hi. Thanks, Paul. I was wondering, a lot of things you're describing seem to echo in a film like Scorsese's Silence. And I know that, or one of the things I've read is that he became passionate a film like that while Last Temptation of Christ was being written. I was wondering what your relationship was, what types of conversations you would have had, or the influence that may have taken place.
Well, I have to be a little careful here because, you know, I'm friends with Mario and we're going to have dinner soon. And I really respect what he did. Silence, there's a trap there. In a way, in Silence, the character from Last Temptation of Christ and the character from Kundun end up arguing and they're both right. So how does that work? You know, the Japanese is saying this and the Jesuit is saying that, and they're both right. And, you know, so it's almost a way in a trap. Another trap he fell into was the fact that when he first fell in love with the book, it was assumed that the missionary enterprise was a benevolent one. Now we assume the opposite. So he, the Indo's book was about, you know, men were trying to do good. Now the moment we see a missionary on screen, we know what they're there for. They're there to get the money. And you know, they're the first phalanx of colonialism. And so our changing attitudes toward the missionary effort also trapped him. But then, you know, you can see in Silence, he's toying around with some of these things. The use of music, static camera, heightened sound effects, but then he changes it, and he changes again, and he changes again. So I found myself kind of torn. But I have only seen it once. And I think it's a film that should be re-seen in out of the context of having to pass judgment on it and wondering why, how much it cost, and how much money it will make.
Yes, there. I know you can't
tell who I'm pointing to. Yes, that was who I was pointing to.
Maybe it's a continuation of the question of the guy in the front, but I'm curious, all this thinking you did about this, how it came through in your early films, like when you were writing Taxi Driver or Raging Bull, they're obviously not understated films, but would you say that this kind of thinking is there on some level?
Yeah, well, absolutely. I mean, as I said, I had no interest in making anything like I was writing about. I was interested in psychological realism. I was interested in action. I was interested in emotional empathy. I was interested in excessive behavior. So I just assumed that I would never circle back to that kind of film. And that was something I had gone through as a film student and as a church student, but not someplace I wanted to be as a filmmaker. And then about 2-3 years ago, I was having dinner with Pavlovsky, this guy who did Eat Up. And we were in New York, and and he was telling me about he was going back to Poland and going to do another film like that. And I walked back to my place in New York, and I said, you know, I think it's time. So I did. I wrote one, and I finished directing it, and now I'm editing it. So I am. It's been a very interesting experience working on the contemplative side, using these techniques. And one of the things I discovered while we were planning and preparing it is the make a rule, break a rule concept. If you make a rule and don't break it, it breaks you. So you go make a rule, make a rule, make a rule. Never move the camera, never tilt, never pan, never tilt pan. Then also break it. But how and when you break it, never use music, but then use music. Never do this, but then do it. Now, how do you make that decision? You know, I remember saying to the DP at the time, I said, I think it's time to break a rule. You know, let's have a Zoom. one Zoom in the whole film, and we're going to put it right here. We're going to break a rule. And why? Why did I feel that, you know, now you're just talking about intuition. And you can write as much about it as you want, but as I said a moment ago, even Bresson doesn't know how you make a Bresson film, because it's intuition.
Someone over here, yes.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Hi, Paul. In 2010, the Cannes Film Festival awarded its coveted Palme d'Or to a movie called Uncle Boonmi, Who Can Recall His Past Lives, Thai filmmaker Ipichitpong Rashikatul. I'd like to get your thoughts on that, and in particular, the strange ending.
You know, he's a very interesting case, and not only just because you can't pronounce his name. He's one of those guys that you kind of respect, but and particularly the last one with the soldiers.
The Splendor.
Yeah, I think I saw that three times, because I figured that it would get its hooks into me sooner or later, because it was so close to stuff I liked, but it never got its hooks into me. How about you?
Yeah, I had the same experience. It has a lot of innovative thinking, creative things that I never would have thought of, had never seen before, but I had a hard time getting carried away in it. And then when you're talking about a slow film, it's you wonder if that's really the criteria you should be using, right? So I'm bored. Well, that's probably a good thing, right? And then you go through this conversation with yourself.
Well, no, that's the whole thing I'm going. You know, I'm just screening my new film now. And what I'm trying to learn is, I know the film has to be too long, because it won't work if it's not too long. But what's the difference between too long and too long? You know, where is that point where all of a sudden you're too long? You know, you say, everybody says, it was a little long, but it was great. And then all of a sudden, at the next point, you say, boy, that was long. And the great part don't get mentioned anymore. So, you know, it's very tricky, you know, as you know, the use of boredom as a tool, because we're so used to using the opposite as a tool, using kineticism as a tool.
Please keep your hand up so they can find you. There you go.
How would you categorize the films of Bergman?
I would say some of them, you know, there's a deep dialectic in there, you know, and so they're almost like arguments. You know, arguments, and some of them actually are arguments. Seventh Seal is actually an argument. In the religious arguments. You know, he's obviously one of the definers of quality in cinema. You know, you really can't have a conversation without Bergman. And he did make some stinkers, too. But he comes from the spiritual, but at his greatest, you know, his greatest film, one of the probably 10 greatest films of all time, is Persona. And I don't know if that's a spiritual film, is it?
I would say so. But I like Tarkovsky, so what do I know?
Oh, no, I like Tarkovsky, too. Persona is not about... Persona is
No, I know what you mean, yeah. Because Persona is very much about spiritual search, but it's largely manifest between two characters.
Yeah. And then,
and
of course...
It's a little different.
One of the great ones, which is Winter Light, which is a devastating film. It's almost about the lack... of spiritual value in a spiritual context. You know, this guy who's going to hold the afternoon service when no one is there. And you don't feel that he's going to be ennobled by it. He's just going to do it. Whereas if he had a real spiritual, that would become the moment when Erland Josephson, I think it is, when he preaches to an empty church. If he wanted, if Bergman really wanted to get spiritual there, then all of a sudden the music would come up. And he would say, he's made it. He has refined himself to the point where he doesn't need an audience anymore.
That's when you know you've arrived, when you don't need an audience anymore. But to stick with Winter Light, and I'm sorry for the spoiler here, but there is a sense, there's more than one empty church to which he has to preach or hold mass
well,
for, right?
A
and there's a chiastic structure to that.
It's only one day. There's a church in the morning and a church in the evening. They're different churches.
Right.
Yeah.
And Bergman's, granted, the ending of the film is open to interpretation, but Bergman suggested that it's actually more hopeful than pessimistic, mm-hmm. hopeful in the direction of faith.
Well, I think that's what he... I just wish he had stepped on the gas a little more. But, you know, that's tricky because you make a false step at the end of the film, you live with it the rest of your life.
Hi, thank you. Excuse me for going off topic, but I was just curious. I wanted to ask, is you when you were...
I'm sorry, we can't hear you.
Can you hear me now? Yeah,
no.
Yeah, just a little louder, please.
Yeah, just wanted to ask, is Travis Bickle, like your motive for creating the character and him becoming a vigilante in the end, was that because of him returning from the Vietnam War and seeing like the state of filth in New York City and realizing he didn't, what he fought for was worthless, or was it because of Betsy and him being lonely? So was it a commentary on society, or was it just his psychological problems that made him a vigilante in the end?
No, Taxi Driver is about the pathological lure of suicidal glory, which in some people would say Christianity is also about. But that character obviously is not, you know, he comes from a Bressonian context, but he is not a Bressonian character. I mean, it was interesting. When I was a film critic, I never imagined being screenwriter, a filmmaker. I was happily a film critic because I just didn't think I'd be any good at this kind of populist entertaining that it took to make films. And then I was reviewing, and Pickpocket was opening in L.A. in 69. And I saw it at a preview, and I wouldn't saw it again. And I went home, and I remember thinking, I could make a film like that. It's just a guy in his room. He goes out, he writes some stuff. He goes out, he does some stuff. He comes back to his room and he writes some more. I could make a film like that. And then 3 years later, I did.
Hi. Just wondering if you could comment on, you mentioned Antonioni, if you could comment on the ending of The Passenger and what your thoughts are on the like extraordinarily long shot in Godard's The Weeknd.
Well, there are two very different purposes involved there. You know, Godard's clearly schematic and is making a caricatured point. Now, Antonioni, I think he made a mistake in that last shot. I think he got suckered. I think he got suckered by the Steadicam and the ability that you could do that, because that shot was not possible a few years before. The camera mode, the Steadicam, and there are a number of films right around that time that are so enamored of this new technology. The same thing happened when the zoom came in, and Visconti started using the zoom all the time because he had never had one before. I think Passenger would have been better if he hadn't had the tools to do that last shot.
And sorry, I have to ask this question.
Rise up, defend yourself, Antonio, any fans.
I have to ask this question because it's come up so many times in the conversation. Why is it that you, or you know, how would you describe Tarkovsky not fitting your definition of transcendental style?
As I said to Joe earlier, I have a feeling that it's about Tarkovsky. Every Tarkovsky movie is about him. And I don't feel that about Bresson. I don't even feel that about Bergman. But I just feel that that he's too involved in his own mythology to take you to where he's been. But that is, you know, that's just a kind of a gut thing, because if he had taken me there, and he has taken other people there, then I would be making the opposite argument.
Yes, right here.
Okay, you mentioned about time, so I would like to know about the definition or your interpretation of a space in their film and the relationship between time and space in their films.
In which film?
All of them, like Bresson's or Ozu. Uh-huh. I can understand sort of, I mean, a space in Ozu's films, but it I cannot understand, you know, the space.
Well, you have to slow time down. You know, it's just like a religious service. You know, there's a kind of contract involved. You go to a church service, you're going to stay for the service, even if you're bored. You made that deal. So you go to a film and they want you to stay, but you're going to be bored. So because they have to stretch out time, just like you do in a church service. There has to be a moment where a moment of prayer where everyone prays on their own. It can be a minute, it can be long, it can be 2-3 minutes long, and then finally the minister interrupts and prays for the group. Well, that's a time technique of just stretching time out. And it's in that moment that you can start to sense what life really is. You know, it's not at all that different from Zen Buddhism and meditation. And all religions have these kinds of techniques. They do in their best way. They also, all religions share some pretty bad things too.
I think we have time for two more questions. I'll take one here on the second row. Can you just wait for the microphone here, because this is being recorded?
Yeah, many claim today that the best writing is happening in television. Have you seen anything that indicates a movement of the transcendental style in television?
No, I don't think that. I think that the confinement of the box of the theater is very good for transcendental style. It really takes a lot of work to make that work at home. And certainly not on a regular basis. Now, there was a film came out a few years ago called Into the Great Silence, a documentary about Carthusian monks. And I started watching it, and I said, whoa, because I'd gotten the DVD. I said, I cannot watch this in the normal context. So I took the coffee table out of the room and turned the lights off and took all the other sensory stimuli away and sat on the floor and watched that movie. Well, that's a kind of commitment, because I knew I could not watch that film in the context of how I would watch a sporting event. I had to make a kind of commitment. So there is something about the commitment. And if you can get people to make that commitment at home, that's great. But you know, once they walk in the theater, just like once they walk in the church, they've made a commitment. You know, they've driven there, they've come, and the odds of them leaving have greatly lessened.
Back here in the back.
That's you.
So this is two parts, perhaps, from my friend Mary, are you still a believer? And from myself, if you can explain perhaps the difference between religious and spiritual for yourself.
Okay. I'm still a churchgoer. I'm a Presbyterian now. I began as Dutch Calvinist. Did a stint as Episcopalian, now I'm Presbyterian. I don't know whether that makes me a believer or not. Maybe I'm a believer in believing. Maybe that's as close as we can ever get. The difference between religion and spirituality, religion is a business. It's a club where a bunch of people get together for material reasons, for social reasons, to wear similar uniforms, to feel the inclusiveness of being in a club where they have rules and where if you disobey the rules, you get punished and you pay your dues. And then they have official things that the club does. And then the club goes on crusades and all those wonderful things that clubs do. That's religion to me. Spirituality is something that happens between a human being and the mystery of life, the mystery of the sensus divinitatis. You know, how did the sense of the divine get implanted in us? Is this something we came up with, or does it express something that is actually out there? Now, religions can help you in this way, but sooner or later, religions are going to start acting like a club, because they're all clubs. And if you're really interested in spiritual matters, you got to watch out for those clubs, because they'll vote you out if you don't believe the way they do.
And if I might just follow up on that real quickly, but you're still a churchgoer. You're still in the club, Paul.
I appreciate the ritual of that. But then I also still go to the Metropolitan Museum every couple of months. So I'm in that club, too.
And I think all of us would admit that we're in the club of cinema. And we're glad to be here. Thank you for your honesty, for your film work, for your writing, and for your time given to us this evening.
Thank you.